sisters and brothers of Nippon. Allow me, first of all, to thank you from the bottom of my heart for the exceedingly warm and cordial welcome you have given us this morning. Allow me also to tell you that during my two visits to your country, whenever I have had occasion to come into contact with your public, I have always met with the greatest courtesy, consideration, and kindness. Such generous behavior and such a magnificent welcome as today's most impressive function helps to bind our two nations closer together and thereby to lay the permanent foundation of a free and united Asia. Allow me now, on behalf of the provisional government of Azad Hind, to thank your government for the honor and the favor of granting us recognition. This provisional government of Azad Hind has been established in accordance with the desire and the will of freedom-loving Indians all over the world. And it has the fullest confidence and support of the entire Indian population in East Asia, numbering about 3 million. The establishment of the provisional government and its recognition by Nippon and other friendly powers on the eve of the commencement of the last phase of our struggle has brought encouragement and inspiration to patriotic Indians all over the world. Friends, permit me now to offer my personal thanks to your great Prime Minister and to his government for the support, sympathy and cooperation that they have given us Indians in East Asia from the very beginning of the war of East Asia. I believe that the Asiatic nations and particularly the Indian people who regard themselves as fortunate in having such a friend and guide in times of crisis. And may I therefore offer my congratulations to you on having such a leader in a war crisis to lead you on to victory and at the same time to carry on the work of reconstruction. Friends, I and my colleagues of the provisional government were fortunate enough to be present at the Assembly of East Asiatic Nations held here in Tokyo, the capital of what I may call the land of the rising sun. I have had some experience of similar international congresses and conferences in the past. I think I am therefore able to form a correct judgment of the value, the worth, and the importance of such a conference as has been held here recently. I will tell you quite frankly and without the slightest exaggeration that the proceedings of this assembly have made the deepest impression on my mind. You have all by now read the joint declaration passed unanimously and enthusiastically by this conference. I regard this joint declaration as a charter of liberty for the nations of East Asia. And I hope and trust that the day will come when this charter of liberty will be also the charter for all the nations of mankind. I therefore offer my respectful congratulations to the Nepalese nation for having taken the initiative of convening this grand and historic assembly. Friends, I am sure that the coming days will show that the representatives of the nations that met here met not only to deliberate, met not only to pass resolutions, but met also for the purpose of action, for the purpose of prosecuting successfully the war of East Asia. And while I am confident that this conference has helped to consolidate our nations, at the same time, it has helped to strike terror in the hearts of the enemy. And so far, as the provisional government of Free India is concerned, and all those who are going to fight under that government, I may tell you that we shall now go to war with the consciousness not only that behind us stands the invincible might of Nippon, but also the united will and the grim determination of all the emancipated nations of East Asia. Friends, in this connection, I must tell you that the announcement just made yesterday by our Prime Minister that the Andaman and Nicobar Islands are going to be handed over to our government will bring joy, encouragement, and inspiration to freedom-loving Indians at home and all over the world. And I'm confident that this act will help even more to bind our two nations closer together. For India, the only path that lies before us is the path of cooperation with Nippon and our allies. So long as Nippon and our allies do not triumph, so long as Anglo-American imperialism is not overthrown, India has no hope of achieving her liberty. We are therefore determined to fight shoulder to shoulder with you, no matter how long and hard the struggle may be, and no matter what the suffering and the sacrifice involved may prove to be. Friends, let me tell you also that for the Indian people, compromise with British imperialism is out of the question. Can we compromise with the robber that has robbed us of our freedom? To compromise with Britain means to compromise with slavery. We shall therefore go on fighting till the bitter end, till the enemy is overthrown and India is free once again. We know that it is only out of the ashes of the British Empire that India can emerge as a free and prosperous nation. Friends, we are conscious that the soil of India is going to be the last theater of war in this part of the world. We have no illusions about the magnitude of the task that awaits us, but we are resolved to pay the price of liberty. In fact, we see today before our mind's eye the historic scenes of bloody battles on the hilly frontiers and on the plains of India. I do not know how many of us who are going to participate in the coming battles will survive to see India free. But whether we survive or not, whether we individually live to see India free or not, we are confident that India shall be free. We are confident that Anglo-American imperialism will be wiped out of India. We are confident that the menace that now hangs over East Asia will be removed once for all. Friends, I know that there are people in this world who have an exaggerated notion of the strength of Britain and of our allies. I was telling this grand assembly yesterday that I have known the British people since I was a child of 5. I know the strength and the weakness of Britain. I know also our own strength and weakness. And I know the strength that stands behind us, ready to give us all sympathy, cooperation and support. Knowing all that, I am confident that however long and hard the struggle may be, there can be but one outcome, namely the destruction of the enemy and our victory and freedom. On the outcome of the coming war depends the fate not only of India, not only of East Asia, but of the whole of Asia and a large portion of the world outside of Asia. Let me therefore give you this solemn assurance. Let me give you and your nation, to your valiant army and navy, this solemn assurance that in this struggle we are with you in life and in death. Friends, in conclusion, let me tell you that all the conditions and the prerequisites of our victory have been achieved. It only remains now to launch the last struggle and to prosecute it with valor and with perseverance till the final goal is reached. That we are now going to do. Thank you.